It's Professor Dave. I want to tell you about eigenvalues and eigenvectors.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
Eigenvalues and eigenvectors represent an incredibly useful concept in linear algebra, and we can see their application not just in math, but also in physics, especially quantum physics, which we have begun to learn about in the Modern Physics series. Eigenvalues can be used to solve systems of linear differential equations, describe natural frequencies of vibrations, separate modes of motion, distinguish states of energy, and much more. So just what are they exactly? Let's say we have matrix A, a square n by n matrix. Eigenvectors are vectors that have a special relationship with matrix A, such that when you multiply A times the eigenvector x, you get back that same vector multiplied by a scalar, lambda. These scalars are called eigenvalues, or sometimes characteristic values. In addition, these eigenvectors must be non-trivial, meaning that they are not just the zero vector. The matrix A can have multiple eigenvalues, but no more than n, the number of rows and columns in the matrix. Furthermore, each eigenvalue will have its own eigenvector that is associated with it. Before we start trying to solve for eigenvalues or eigenvectors, let's see them in action so we can further cement the definition we just mentioned. Let's say that matrix A is a 2x2 matrix with elements negative 3, 1, negative 2, and 0. Now let's check that the vector x equals 1, 1 is an eigenvector. To do this, we will simply multiply A by x and see if we get back x multiplied by some scalar. Performing the multiplication, we get negative 3 times 1 plus 1 times 1, negative 2 times 1 plus 0 times 1, or negative 3 plus 1, negative 2 plus 0, which simplifies to negative 2, negative 2. We can simply factor out a negative 2 from this and get negative 2 times 1, 1, which is just our original vector multiplied by negative 2. We have not only verified that 1, 1 is in fact an eigenvector of our matrix, but also discovered that negative 2 is one of its eigenvalues. Now that we are better acquainted with eigenvalues and eigenvectors, let's start learning how to solve for them. We know that the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of a square matrix A obey the equation Ax equals lambda x. In order to solve this, we will first subtract lambda x from both sides. Then, in between lambda and x, we will insert the identity matrix I, which is the matrix equivalent of multiplying by 1, so we are not changing the equation by doing this. Now we have Ax minus lambda Ix equals the zero vector. If we factor out the vector, we can rewrite this as the quantity A minus lambda I times x equals the zero vector. Now we want non-trivial solutions to this equation, meaning that x can't be the zero vector. Let's see what this means for A minus lambda I. If this matrix were invertible, then we could multiply both sides by A minus lambda I inverse and get x equals A minus lambda I inverse times the zero vector, which would mean that x is zero. To avoid this situation, A minus lambda I can't be invertible, and therefore, as we recall from learning about inverse matrices, the determinant of this matrix must be zero. The determinant of A minus lambda I will form a polynomial in lambda often referred to as the characteristic polynomial, and the equation formed when the determinant equals zero is called the characteristic equation. The solutions to this equation will be our eigenvalues. Let's try a concrete example so that this will make more sense. Consider matrix A, which equals 1, 1, 4, 1. We will take this matrix and subtract lambda I, where I is the 2x2 matrix with ones on the main diagonal and zeros for the other two entries. Multiplying by lambda, we simply end up with lambdas on the main diagonal. And so, in performing the subtraction, we will simply end up subtracting lambda from the main diagonal of A. That gives us 1 minus lambda, 1, 4, 1 minus lambda. Now, we must take the determinant of this matrix and set it equal to 0. The determinant will be 1 minus lambda times 1 minus lambda, minus the quantity 4 times 1. Foiling out this first term leaves us with 1 minus 2 lambda plus lambda squared minus 4. If we simplify and then set this equal to 0, that will give us a characteristic equation of lambda squared minus 2 lambda minus 3 equals 0. If we recall our basic algebra, we can easily factor this, rewriting it as lambda minus 3 times lambda plus 1 equals 0. This means that we have two solutions, 3 and negative 1. These are the eigenvalues. So to summarize what we just did, we found the determinant of A minus lambda I and set it equal to 0, which was our characteristic equation. And then solving that equation gave us a pair of eigenvalues. Once we have found the eigenvalues for a matrix, we can start solving for the eigenvectors. This takes a bit more effort, and it must be done for each eigenvalue separately. We will once again start the process by examining the A minus lambda I part of A minus lambda I times x equals the 0 vector. This time, we will actually plug in one of the eigenvalues we found for lambda and get a new matrix. This new matrix, multiplied by our unknown vector x, equals 0. So in essence, what we are left with is a system of equations that we can solve by any method we've learned so far. The most consistent method here is to use row operations to get the matrix into row echelon form. There will be times when we must choose values for the components of the eigenvectors, but it doesn't really matter what we choose, because the solution we find by doing so only represents the form of eigenvectors. Any scalar multiple of the vector we find through this method will also be an eigenvector. We can easily demonstrate this as follows. Assume the vector x is an eigenvector of A, so ax equals lambda x. Now, if we consider the vector cx, where c is a scalar, then a times this new vector can also be written as c times ax, since c is just a scalar. We already know ax equals lambda x, so this becomes c lambda x, which can be rewritten as lambda cx. So we get acx equals lambda cx, which makes the vector cx an eigenvector by definition. To make this process of solving for eigenvectors a little more clear, let's once again consider the matrix A equals 1, 1, 4, 1. We have already found the eigenvalues of this matrix to be 3 and negative 1, so let's use these to find the related eigenvectors. We can start with lambda equals 3 and plug this into A minus lambda I. We end up getting 3s on this main diagonal, which means we will be subtracting 3 from the diagonal elements of A, leaving us with negative 2, 1, 4, negative 2. Now, once we have this, we will have to use row operations to get this in row echelon form. In this case, we can simply add 2 times the first row to the second row to get a new second row. This turns the second row into zeros, and we are left with negative 2 and 1 in the first row. Recall that we are solving the matrix equation A minus lambda I times x equals 0, so this matrix multiplied by x equals 0. Writing x as x1, x2, and doing matrix multiplication, we end up with the equation negative 2x1 plus x2 equals 0. Moving 2x1 to the other side, that leaves us with x2 equals 2x1. Let's now choose x1 to be equal to 1, which makes x2 equal to 2. So for the eigenvalue lambda equals 3, we get the eigenvector x equals 1, 2. However, recall that this vector only represents the form eigenvectors take for this eigenvalue. We can have any multiple of this vector, and it will still be an eigenvector. To put it simply, any vector where the second element is twice the first will be an eigenvector. Now let's do the same thing for lambda equals negative 1. We once again go back to a minus lambda I, this time plugging in negative 1 for lambda. In this case, by subtracting negative 1 from the main diagonal of A, we find the result to be 2, 1, 4, 2. For our row operation this time, we will subtract 2 times the first row from the second row to get a new second row. We are left with 2 and 1 in the first row, which this time makes our equation 2x1 plus x2 equals 0. Moving x1 to the other side, we are left with x2 equals negative 2x1. Keeping it simple, let's again choose 1 for x1, and we get x2 equals negative 2, making our vector x equals 1, negative 2. Again, any multiple of this vector will also qualify. So the eigenvectors for lambda equals negative 1 are vectors with their second element being equal to negative 2 times the first element. Now that we've gotten our feet wet, let's go through one more example to really make sure we understand this process. This time, let's take our matrix A to be 1, 0, 0, 3, negative 2, 0, 2, 3, 4. And for this, we will find the eigenvalues and eigenvectors. First, to find the eigenvalues, let's find A minus lambda I, which will mean subtracting lambda from the terms in the main diagonal of A. Then we will take the determinant of this new matrix and set the polynomial equal to 0. Thanks to the form of our matrix, with 2 zeros in the top row, the determinant of A minus lambda I is relatively simple. We get 1 minus lambda times negative 2 minus lambda times 4 minus lambda minus 0 times 3, then minus 0, and then plus 0. This simplifies to the product of these three binomials, and setting this equal to 0, we end up with a characteristic equation that is already completely factored. 1 minus lambda times negative 2 minus lambda times 4 minus lambda equals 0. So our solutions are lambda equals 1, lambda equals negative 2, and lambda equals 4, and these are the eigenvalues for this matrix. Now that we have the eigenvalues, we can solve for the eigenvectors that are related to each of them. Let's start with lambda equals 1. We will go back to our matrix given by A minus lambda I, and plugging in lambda equals 1, we will subtract 1 from the terms in the main diagonal to get the matrix 0, 0, 0, 3, negative 3, 0, 2, 3, 3. We could go through row operations from here, but the form of our matrix in this case makes it simple to solve if we jump right into equation form. The top row gives no information, but the second row tells us 3x1 minus 3x2 equals 0. Solving this, we see that x1 equals x2, and for this case, let's choose x2 to be 1. So both x1 and x2 are therefore equal to 1. The final row tells us that 2x1 plus 3x2 plus 3x3 equals 0, but we've already chosen x1 and x2 to be equal to 1, so plugging those values in, we get 2 plus 3 plus 3x3 equals 0. We end up getting x3 equals negative 5/3, making our eigenvectors any multiple of 1, 1, negative 5/3. Next, we will find the eigenvectors for lambda equals negative 2. Plugging this value into A minus lambda I, we subtract negative 2 from the main diagonal to get 3, 0, 0, 3, 0, 0, 2, 3, 6. Expressing this in equation form, the first row tells us that 3x1 equals 0, so x1 must be 0. The second row tells us the same thing. Meanwhile, the final row becomes 2x1 plus 3x2 plus 6x3 equals 0. We already know that x1 is 0, so we are left with 3x2 plus 6x3 equals 0, or x2 equals negative 2x3. We will now choose x3 to be 1, making x2 equal to negative 2. so the eigenvectors have the form 0, negative 2, 1. And finally, let's do the third eigenvalue, lambda equals 4. The matrix A minus lambda I requires subtracting 4 from the main diagonal, so this becomes negative 3, 0, 0, 3, negative 6, 0, 2, 3, 0. The first row tells us that negative 3x1 equals 0, so once again, x1 is 0. The second row tells us 3x1 minus 6x2 equals 0, but since x1 is 0, we are left with negative 6x2 equals 0, so x2 must also be 0. The third row becomes 2x1 plus 3x2 equals 0. We already know that both x1 and x2 are 0, but we have no information about x3. This makes x3 a free variable. In this case, we can just choose one, making our eigenvectors have the form 0, 0, 1. Now that we have sufficiently discussed the important process of finding eigenvalues and eigenvectors, let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.